gospel to preach to those who are on earth. Sing with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come. And worship him who made heaven and earth and the sea and the springs of waters. Well, the book of Revelation is a book about Jesus. It's all about him. Revelation 1:1, it's a revelation of Jesus Christ. And he is the star of the book. Everything in there points to Jesus. In fact, when it says to worship him who made, it's really a call to understand, among other things, that the one who made you is the one who died on the cross.
Amen.
Your creator cares so much about you, he doesn't want to see you die. He would die in your place. And it's an amazing good news story. It's an everlasting gospel. Well, okay, so as we understand that, this is about Jesus. Worship him who made. Now, the book of Revelation is a book of endings, and the Adventist Church is an expert in prophecy. We feel God has given us some real light in that subject, and so you will hear per Sabbath more from the book of Revelation than just about any other place in town.
Amen.
Right? You're going to hear lots about Revelation. And so we are an expert on the book of endings. Well, I'd like to suggest to you that we should become equally expert on the book of beginnings. My favorite book, the book of Genesis. So many things begin, and we find out how they turn out in Revelation. Like Israel and Babylon are started, and then we get the ending in Revelation. Now, you've already seen me enough to know that I use humor whenever I can. And partly that's just my personality, but partly it's also a premeditated thing to talk about things that has tension wrapped up around it. And that's like origins. And so I try to use humor to get some common ground and some ease of the tension, kind of let out some steam. Having said that, when I come to this verse in the Bible, I feel I should remove my shoes because it's sacred ground. In fact, I'd like you to read this with me. Here we go. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. What more do you need to know? There it is. When there was a beginning, God was already there. And everything that we know about, heavens and earth and everything therein, was made by him. That includes us. So our primary relationship with God is creature to creator. And if we get that, I mean, the rest of the Bible is pretty much commentary. That's a little bit of a stretch. But anyway, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. No greater statement of truth has ever been written or coined or spoken on planet Earth. Okay, so if God is the maker, you saw some of these slides last night. What did he make? Did he make simply matter? Did he make organic molecules? Did he let them evolve after that? Did he make life in some form? Did he make something a little closer to us? Did he make man, as scripture says? Or did he have nothing to do with it? And trust me, there are people that think that nothing to do with us being here. And you heard my story last night about my major professor at UC Riverside, who had a belief in God, but he didn't know how to use God in the big picture of did he have anything to do with us being here? Okay, so there are people who struggle with that. In fact, I have to tell you that Seventh-day Adventists are among one or two of the major denominations of the many that still believe in Genesis. Because here we go, Roman Catholic Church, two popes have written articles where they believe that man is evolved. And at some point, God looked upon some kind of a knuckle-dragger that was a proto-Adam, created some sort of a soul, put it in there, and that was a special act of creation, so scientists, that's where we're putting our camp. Special act of creation, put a soul in him, man became self-aware and aware of God, and that was the beginning of man. Okay? Church of England, Presbyterian Church, Methodist Church, some Lutheran churches, in fact, I asked a Mormon once, do you know what your church believes as far as origins are concerned? And I said, I don't think they have a position. You can believe whatever you want. Okay. All right. Okay. So the point is, there's precious few churches today that believe in Genesis to Revelation. Okay. This is when you go to a museum, you are going to a cathedral of atheism. All right? And this is presented as our family tree. We are hairless apes. I don't know how you, in my family, I'm the family tree guy. Every family seems to have one of those, right? I don't know, maybe you are that for your family. I interviewed my great aunts while they were still alive, told me back of stories in the 1890s. So I wrote all that down, recorded it and everything. As I study my family, I get an idea of who I am, because they all contributed to my self-image. How does that affect your self-image? Great-grandpa was a Hudson, but great-great-great-great-great-great-grandpa was an ooh-ooh-geek-geek of some kind. And how does that affect your self-image? In other words, so when you go to a museum, you're going to a cathedral of atheism. So we looked at this slide last night, and again, just to remind you, Gallup polls show that in America, in 2014, the second most recent poll, 42% of Americans believed in a biblical account of some kind. Theistic evolution was God driving evolution. That is 31%, and then 19% for no God. Nature is sufficient to create and organize itself. That was the numbers from that year. But 2017, just a few months ago, released, the numbers are like this. And so we see creationism slowly but surely sinking, although the slack has been picked up by theistic evolution, and then naturalism stayed the same. You know what? What is theistic evolution? Theistic evolution is born in a culture that has a high view of science, all right, a high view, high respect for science. Science has given us CDs and Pop-Tarts, so how could they be wrong about anything? And then a high view of religion. And so you're trying to put those two things together, and somehow or other, you probably don't think too much about how it's melding. Just don't think about it, but somehow try to hold on to both. Okay, well, we'll talk a little bit about the implications of theistic evolution as we get into the talk today. And then also you saw last night that familiar with creationism is going down. So Americans do not have a very good sense of what creationists believe. That's my job. And yet here's an attempt to try to put out information for you. Here's Dennis Noble. Dennis Noble is a physiologist, makeup of the body, from Oxford University in England. He is the head of a physiological society in England. And this is what he wrote recently to his colleagues on the subject of evolution. He is an evolutionist. And the most popular belief today about what pushes evolution is mutations. In other words, an oops between parent and child. Somehow the DNA is not copied exactly. It's a mutation, it's a mistake. So all of us here are basically the result of thousands of mistakes that just so happen to go into the direction of us being more than pond scouts. So anyway, it's a single cell life form. Anyway, that is the popular view of evolution. That's called neo-Darwinism, the modern synthesis. Darwinism was survival of the fittest. They've rejected that now for neo-Darwinism. Now notice what this believer in evolution says, top scientist: all the central assumptions of the modern synthesis, neo-Darwinism, have been disproved. Now what does he say? He's saying anything that we can test about mutations changing us, pushing evolution to where we are today, anything that we can test is failing in science. It's being disproved. Are you with me on this? Not even not proved, disproved. So what is he writing to his fellow scientists? He's basically saying, we need to come up with a better explanation of what makes evolution work. Because the popular views are failing us when we test them in the laboratory. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
So in other words, the point is, do you ever see this on PBS? You ever see this, National Geographic? the article, the fact, you know, the front page article. Modern synthesis, neo-Darwinism failing according to modern scientists to explain evolution. No, and you're not going to, but anyway, so kind of interesting. It's up to us to get that information out. When the scientists talk among themselves, which is what this is, a letter to other scientists, it's interesting how honest they can sometimes be with the problems. Okay. So Jesus said to the woman at the well, the Father is looking for those who will worship him in spirit and in truth. What does that mean? I think that that means God is looking for people who worship from the heart, but also from the head, who know who they're worshiping and have and are knowledgeable worshipers. So I'm believing God wants us to know as much as we can handle. Do you believe that?
Amen.
All right, so here we go. Back to this verse. Let's unpack a little bit in a way you've not heard in an Adventist church before, I think. Let's start off with fear God and give glory to Him. What we typically say fear means. What? Revere, respect. We soften it, don't we? Don't we? We soften it. And I get that, because to know God is to not fear. And the more we know about God, the less we are afraid of Him. We know that love casts out fear. Yes, this is not a message to the church. This is a message to every tribe, tongue, and people. This is to the world that does not know God. And I'm going to suggest to you that the word might mean fear. I know that's a stretch of translation. Why? Because remember what Jesus said. He said, why do you guys worry about people that can harm the body? I mean, shouldn't you be more worried about somebody who has your eternal destiny in their hands? You know, it's kind of like, what do you want to worry about today? You're going to worry about something. We're all wired, I think, to worry. At least I think that. I was raised by a mother. So, lots of things to worry about. How about this? If there's anything you've ever chosen to worry, how about worrying about, am I ready to meet God? Is there anything more significant than that? So to a world that has not thought about this, a world that isn't ready to meet the return of its creator, maybe they should be afraid about that moment if they're not ready. Okay, all right, I'm not going to make a big deal out of that. Let's let it go. For the hour's judgment has come, that's serious, and worship him who made heaven and earth to see. Where do we see those three phrases in that order in the Bible? Shh. Where? It's not Genesis, it's Exodus. It's Exodus 20. It's the seventh commandment. Okay, from now on, you be quiet. I've got another one coming up. You be quiet. We Seventh-day Adventists have correctly seen this last day message before Jesus comes, the call to worship God as creator. We have correctly seen that there's a hint of Sabbath keeping in there. In other words, hey, if you're going to worship God as creator, why not go back to Genesis and look at that story? You'll find out God set something up to help us remember God as creator. There it is. It's the Sabbath commandment. But, okay, you've got all that before. But, have you ever seen what the springs of waters is a reference to? What's the springs of water a reference to? It's the flood. It's a reference to the flood. Let me tell you why. First of all, it's a judgment hour message. But secondly, the terms in the Greek language there for springs. Have you ever heard of the Septuagint version of the Bible? Septuagint version was the first Old Testament translation. It was from Hebrew into Greek because Hebrew scholars living in Alexandria, Egypt, had a bunch of kids, and they couldn't read Hebrew. And they wanted them to read the Bible, but they couldn't read Greek. So they translated the Bible into a language they could read. It was Greek. That Old Testament translation of the Septuagint, we see lots of evidence for in the New Testament. In other words, Paul and the disciples seemed to carry Septuagints with them. And many of their many of their verses from the Old Testament are clearly Septuagint translations. So, when you get to the fountains of the waters in the Greek Genesis account, where it says, and all the fountains of the great deep were broken up, that fountains is the same word for springs in the Revelation account. If you were reading the Bible in the Bible days, in John's day, who wrote Revelation, you would immediately see that reference to the flood. Oh, that's a description of the waters of the flood. Why would it be an important reference at this time in the first angel's message to the world about a judgment hour? Doesn't it make sense? Doesn't it give it oomph when you start talking about, oh, and yes, this is the God that sent the first great world judgment in the form of the flood. So he's about ready to do it again, this time with fire. You with me? In other words, he's going to cleanse the world again, this time with fire. Well, okay, so talk about global warming. Okay, another angel followed, saying with a loud voice, Babylon has fallen. Now, what is Babylon doing right next to a call to worship God as creator? What's Babylon got to do? You know, come out of Babylon, worship God as creator. What, is there a hint there? Let's go back to the story of the beginning of Babylon. Where did that start? What was the story? Tower of Babel. What's behind the building of the Tower of Babel? Why did they build the Tower of Babel? To save themselves from a future judgment, right? In case the waters come back again, they wanted to get above that. But there's other reasons. There's several reasons why they built the tower. What's another one? Make a great name for themselves. What else? Reach up to God. Maybe a stairway to heaven. Maybe self-knowing. Okay. I'm still looking for one, though, that's somewhat obscure. You've got to think about this. Why are they getting up into the heavens?
Be closer to God.
Distrust.
Tell you what. Think of it this way. And if you read Patriarchs and Prophets, it's listed as one of the reasons they built the tower. The people of the flood were looking for a naturalistic explanation for what had just happened. Not supernatural, natural. They doubted that it was a supernatural event. They wanted to start. In fact, I'm curious as to why almost all the buildings we find post-flood, early post-flood, have an interest in studying the stars. Now, what typically do we say? Oh, they're all worshiping the stars. Okay, that's what they're doing. I don't know, but they're certainly studying them at least. And maybe they're all curious to see if something else is going to come from up there. And it may reference the meteors being involved with the flood, but that's just another thing on the side. Be sure to come to my flood talk when we do that later in the week. Okay, so Babylon may be reference to naturalism. And we'll see how that works in a little bit. We talked about Darwin last night. For those of you who were, how many of you were here last night? About half, maybe. Okay, so the rest of you it's new to. Let's talk about Charles Darwin for a minute. A couple days ago, it was Darwin's birthday. Did you celebrate? Okay. Charles Darwin, he was trained to be a minister, Church of England, how about that? Trained to be a minister, and yet I blame Cambridge for the evolution, or what he brought to the science table. Want to know why? Because the Cambridge religion department, there was only one of their professors that believed in Genesis being literal. The rest of them saw it as symbolic and whatever. So the religion he was taught with already was removing the supernatural part of the Bible to making it simply a bunch of nice religious tales. Are you with me? So what was the image of God he was getting? God was not behind the Bible. It was a bunch of well-intended ancient people who wrote the Bible. So already he's getting a very poor religious training. But anyway, so went to the Galapagos Islands to study the islands as the shipboard naturalist. I don't know if you know about, John Kralinsky and I have a radio program called, what? Sing the Beagle. We call Sing the Beagle. I don't know if you remember a few years ago, there was a big one about Sing the Bismarck. Anyway, Sing the Beagle, we came up with that. And it's a 15-minute program on Lifetalk Radio. I don't know if you get that around here. But we start off with Gilligan's Island theme. You know, back in the day, Darwin set sail on the HMS Beagle. We played up there. Oh, well. Anyway, we have fun. And we take pot shots at some of the issues involving origins. We have a lot of fun. We use modern science and scripture to look at serious issues in the subjects of origins. Anyway, so Darwin published Origin of Species in 1859. He wrote it in 1844. You ever heard of that date before Adventists? 1844 is when he wrote the manuscript. He waited 15 years to publish it for a variety of reasons, waiting that long. What did he see in the Galapagos Islands as the naturalist on the HMS Beagle, the map-making tour from the British government? He saw at the local Safeway market tortoises for sale in the meat department. And the shape of the shells, according to the local salesman, would tell them what island it came from in the Galapagos. Now, we thought that was interesting. How could they have different shaped shells in different islands? But they probably had a common ancestor, which is probably true. Same thing with the finches that he gathered. He took them back to England, and he was told by a British ornithologist that these are all finches. And he had some doubts about that. Look at the different beaks. And yet they were all finches. Again, he imagined that they had a common ancestor. And actually, I think that was probably so. Creationists used to not want to give that to evolutionists. We used to say, no. Species are fixed. There's no changing ever. We now know that there is some, but a bird is still a bird, a finch is still a finch. Okay. Darwin eventually had a fan by the name of Adolf. And what Adolf saw, as others did, is that now we have a scientific reason for certain races being superior to others. So take a look, that's the total title of his book, The Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection, that's survival of the fittest, or the preservation of favored races. How are they favored? That they're favored by nature. Nature selects them as favored in the struggle for life. So the races that are in charge of the planet are there because they are fit to do that. Okay, are you with me? So anybody subjugated as oppressed people are oppressed because they aren't fit to be anything else. Are you with me? So when you remove God from the picture, what else? There's only biology going on. There's only animals against other animals. We're all hairless animals. So that's all we are. And races may become superior in their position in the world because they are being selected by nature that way. So, interesting. Already the social implications of Darwinian thinking becomes evident from page one. Okay, so, evolution tree of life. There we are. There's with our family up there with the chimps and the lemurs. And we're going to talk, when we talk about the fossil record, when we talk about the flood, the fossil record is not the friend of evolution. You've heard of missing links? That's not accurate. There are missing chains. Okay? So, and I'll give you some quotes from leading evolutionists to talk about that's one of the great trade secrets of the problem among paleontologists. That they have evidence for fish, but no pre-fish. Frogs, but no pre-frogs. Dinosaurs. I've got a great quote from a dinosaur expert. There are no ancestors known in the fossil record for dinosaurs. So on and on it goes. We'll talk on Monday night about the evolution evidence for man. That's a big one. Okay, so facts about Darwin real quickly. Grandfather was an evolutionist. Yeah, Darwin was not the one who came up with the theory of evolution. Just the mechanism that made sense. That is survival of the fittest. Nature selects the parents of each animal by their fitness. that over time will change animals toward whatever, super fit. Now, actually, we see there may be something to that, that all that's doing is making a very healthy animal. Lion, tiger, or bear. It's a very good and solid and strong, but not a new kind of animal. Are you with me? Because nothing new is being added. All right, and evolutionists agree to that, and that's why they're backing away from Darwinian thinking into neo-Darwin, that is mutations. His dad was a big doctor who was kind of on Charles to make something of himself. There was the usual pressure. Right, dads? We know what this is. Susanna Wedgwood was his mother, but died when Darwin was only 8 years old. He was born 2 days ago in 1809. 2 days ago in 1809. That doesn't sound right. Anyway, February 22, 1809, the same day that who was born? Abraham Lincoln. Isn't that interesting? Same day and year that Abraham Lincoln was born. Trained to be a minister. Got a bachelor's degree from Cambridge. Did not get anything more than that earned. He did get an honorary master's from Cambridge later. Signed up for this tour. Published Origin of Species in 1859, when there was a perfect storm of evolution in Europe. He went from Church of England to deist to agnostic. Notice how if you believe in evolution, you will eventually move away from God. And that's what he did. Are you with me? Do this. It's true. It's true. We see, and that's what America is doing a little bit too, as Europe already has. His wife, Emma, remains steadfast Christian. And incidentally, the reason I'm saying that is because you see less and less a need for God as evolution becomes bigger and bigger and the creator of new life and species and so forth. You know, need God. So, anyway. A lifelong Christian. Have you ever heard of the story that Darwin supposedly reconverted on his deathbed? Have you ever heard that story? We know about that story. We know exactly where it came from. Unfortunately, it's not true. And that's sad. We think it was an American woman evangelist who actually visited him on his deathbed, wrote about it years later, and made it sound like he came back to the Lord. What probably happened was he was very polite with her and sang a hymn with her and maybe let her pray for him. But beyond that, the family and the servants were very clear that nothing changed in Darwin. Now, if you want to be cynical about it, and you know I'm never humorous on such things, there's a bumper sticker that you can get that says, Darwin knows now. Okay, not our theology. Anyway, sorry. My wife's not here. That's the sole reason why I said that. Died in 1882 and is buried in Westminster Abbey, the State Church of England. Okay? I want you to catch this following statement from the Church of England, their website, the director of PR making a statement in 2009 on the 200th anniversary of his birth. Charles Darwin, 200 years from your birth, the Church of England owes you an apology for misunderstanding you and by getting our first reaction wrong, encouraging others to misunderstand you still. Okay, we owe you an apology. What were we thinking? When you came along and said God didn't create us at all and the Genesis account is fiction, what were we thinking when we gave you hassles on that? Silly us. What were we doing? You know what? And I do believe good religion needs good science. I'm not sure if that's going on there. But anyway, I want you to think about this for a minute. Church of England, William Tyndale, John Wycliffe, men willing to die to preserve the English Bible for us to read today. And here you have somebody, and that's Church of England produced, here you have somebody completely trashing the Bible, and the Church of England is trying to be nice with them. We owe you an apology for having a problem with let's face it, right? Science. How can a fish swallow somebody? How can the sun move backwards? How How can somebody be raised from the dead? These are just well-intended stories. They're religious. They have nice, happy endings. They're warm and fuzzies, but come on. And so whenever you remove the supernatural aspects of the Bible, whenever you take miracles away from God, then who's in the Bible? Who is that person that you call God? If I ask for a miracle, is he able to deliver? Apparently not, because science has shown. So, Church of England, where are you today? An issue always for any topic, any doctrine, primarily where the rubber meets the road, is what it tells you about God. Whether it's a false doctrine or a true doctrine, how does it color God?
Amen.
Here's what I want you to get, and this is, talk about translations, Crazy Eric. Here's a translation we don't usually use, American Standard Version. I'm going with his own title, so it's respectful. I always call people what they want to be called. Matthew 10:29, American Standard Version is the most accurate on this, because look what Jesus is saying to the church, his disciples. He says, are not two sparrows sold for a penny? You guys, you church people, think a sparrow's worth a half a penny. That's what you think. But that's not what the Father thinks. Not one of them shall fall on the ground without your Father. Now, most of your translations say without your Father's will. Will is supplied. It is not in the Greek. I want you to catch what Jesus is saying here. To me, it's massive. No sparrow falls alone. Did you catch that? No sparrow falls alone. The Father is present when a sparrow falls. Now, the subject is the value of sparrows. What Jesus is saying is a sparrow is worth so much more to the Father than half a penny. Now, to me, this is astounding, because if you were a theistic evolutionist, you believe in God, but you believe in evolution, you would just completely disagree with this that Jesus said, because the Father doesn't think sparrows are worth anything. Let's let a million generations of sparrows die to get us to where we are today, and everything else in the animal kingdom, millions of generations die to get us to where we are today, and that's the way God creates new life forms. Remember, evolution says that the way to get a new species is to let another one die off. So it's death that drives a certain portion of the thinking about evolution. Get rid of the old and in with the new. And that's the way God has created us? This would disagree with what Jesus said about the Father. No sparrow dies alone. Isn't that amazing? And you know what Jesus says right after this? Don't worry, you're worth more than many sparrows. He never says you're worth more than all the sparrows. That's not bumping your value down. That's bumping sparrows' values up. Are you with me? Sparrows are valuable to God. All of God's animals are valuable to God. He built an ark to save animals. Animals are going to be in the new heavens and the new earth. God loves animals. God does not kill animals to make new species. And if he takes a million years to create us, is he going to take a million years to create a new heaven and a new earth too? If he is a powerful God and he can create any way he wants to, if he's a big and powerful God, then why would he use millions of generations of dead animals to get us to where we are today? You just make God the author of death. And that death is not an intruder, that Jesus has to conquer as some enemy, is part of God's plan. So you see what you're laying at the doorstep of God if you are a theistic evolutionist. Why do you need a savior that'll come and conquer death if death is part of the plan? It's complicated when you go theistic. Here is a verse in the Bible directed towards Seventh-day Adventists, primarily. Are you ready for this? Scoffers will come in the last day. What's a scoffer? making fun of something. Making fun of something that somebody's talking about. Oh, what are they talking about? Where is the promise of his coming? You guys have been, you Adventists have been talking about the second advent of Christ for so long. Where is he? Where is the promise of coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning without any major interruption by God into the world of man like you're talking about. He's never done that before. Okay. For this they willfully forget, and by the word of God the heavens were old, they willfully ignore evidence of creation, and also the flood, and the earth standing out of water, which was flooded with water. So they ignore the evidence of Genesis. Okay? Doesn't that kind of sound like where we are today? Adventists is talking about the second coming. Adventists are talking about believe in God who made, who flooded, who judged, the creator, the judge. Okay. Is it good news that God is a judge? Hey, his son is our attorney. It's pretty good. Got good news. Okay. All right. Now, Pastor. Trivia question to see if you know your Bibles. Three times in Jesus' ministry, a voice came from heaven, audible voice from heaven, three times in Jesus' ministry. What were those times? Baptism? Not a transfiguration?
Cross.
Cross? Nope. That's okay. You're very average here. We often get quiet. Huh? Okay, you didn't say anything. Oh, not me. Okay. Where was the third time? It's in John chapter 12. Don't look down. John chapter 12. And let me set it up for you. And we also get a little help from a Desire of Ages as to where this took place. Here it is. Greeks want to see Jesus. So they come to the temple court area. And the temple court, you must understand, originally had a barricade to where Greeks could not go past. All right? In fact, they've even found the original sign that's in a museum in Jerusalem today. No Greeks, no Gentiles allowed past this sign on pain of death. Okay? So, Jews only could be, you know, circumcised only on the other side of this barricade. So, this is how I picture the story unfolding. And there's a chapter in Desire of Ages on this. The Greeks come up to this barricade and they look for Jesus. Jesus is in the Jewish section. There's the disciples with him. One of the disciples a little closer, and so I can see something like this. Sir! Sir! No! Sir! And Philip comes over and probably says something like, can I help you? These are Greeks. All right. And the Greeks ask the question of all time. Can we see Jesus? How many of you want to see Jesus?
Amen.
Sir, we would see Jesus. Give me that. I want to see Jesus. I'm in that line. I'm a Greek. So, Philip probably says, let me get back to you on that. And he goes not to Jesus, he goes to Andrew. And probably says something like, Andrew, come here. There's some Greeks that want to see Jesus. What should we do? I mean, will he get in trouble if he's seen speaking to Greeks here in front of so many religious, you know, and I mean, thinking about, you know, what should we do here? And Andrew probably said something like this. Have you seen what Jesus does when we try to keep people from him? Not going there. And so I can imagine Philip saying, you're right. So they go to Jesus, and they say, Jesus, there are some Greeks here that want to see you. Jesus lights up by your light. If I can paraphrase what he says, it's something like, this is what it's all about.
Amen.
I came not just to the Jews, I came for the world. And he looks to heaven and he says, Father, glorify me with the name that we had before. And the Father speaks and says, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. Wow, a voice from heaven. All of this I'm sharing with you to get to the next section, the next track, text. It's their reaction. Therefore, the people who stood by and heard it said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Now, what are the ways of classifying those two responses for that event? Thunder, angel. Nature, supernatural. Are you with me? Natural explanation, supernatural explanation. I can see somebody saying, boy, did you hear that thunder? That was really thunder. Did you hear? Tell me that was thunder. And I can see somebody coming back at them saying, that was a voice. And you hear it was a voice. And to this day, and I shared this with the geoscience scientists in Loma Linda, they'd never heard this before. This is two interpretations for the same data, the same experience. They're both right there. Why do they see it so differently? Is it possibly because of different glasses? In other words, one is open to the idea of supernatural. I believe there is a supernatural source, and there's more than we can see. Another would have a tendency to think, no, this is, but there's got to be a natural explanation for this. You see? It's the way they interpret. That's why you can take people to the Grand Canyon, and you look at the rock layers there, and you can say, if you're an evolutionist, you say, man, look at that! Millions of years! And if you are a creationist and believe in the flood, wow, look at that! The flood! And there will always be two sets of interpretations for the same data right until Jesus comes. And it has not to do with the data, but with the glasses. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So that's kind of what we're dealing with here a little bit. Incidentally, Jesus said it's a voice. And he said, hey, I didn't need the voice. Oh, guys are lucky. God just gave you more evidence of my ministry, my work. And so the Greeks got to hear the voice. Pretty cool. So how many of you remember from class in school those wonderful words that a teacher might occasionally say to you? I thought about it. I'm going to let you guys take the test again. Retaking a test. Is that a good? Those were good news in school. Guess what? We get to take the test again. Where Eve failed. Because when God said to Eve, that fruit is toxic, don't eat the fruit. Eve got out her scientific equipment and she looked for toxicity. She studied the surroundings. She studied the effect that it had on the serpent. The serpent could now talk. She looked at it and it appeared to be good. Everything that she could reason with, everything that she could perceive and observe told her one thing. God's word was over here. She went with her observations. The question that I have for you is God's word sufficient for you?
Amen.
Is it enough for you? Incidentally, who was right? God was right. It was, turned out to be a toxic thing. So, here is what church? This is Westminster Abbey. And buried there in the floor is Charles Robert Darwin. The other thing you might notice is nobody in church. Okay, no, that's a set-up picture, I know. It's a set-up picture. The Church of England today is dead, spiritually. Comparatively dead. Less than 10% of the people in England go to any church on a Sunday. Church, England is post-Christian like the rest of Europe. Are you with me? This strikes home for me. Why? Because my great-grandfather worked 20 years in Westminster Abbey. My grandfather was born in London. My mother's side of the family come from Church of England originally. And for me to think of what Church of England used to be compared to what it has become is a depressing story for me. The moral of the story is, don't bring Darwin to church. Because if you take the supernatural aspects of God out of the Bible and you present that God to England, who needs a God who doesn't answer prayers in miraculous ways, who's controlled by nature, who is subservient to nature? Who needs a God like that? There's no power. There's no Holy Spirit power. There's no answers to prayers. There's no presence of God. There's no magnificence of God. God has become very small. And I don't know about you, but I need a big God.
Amen.
And the size of the universe tells me it's a big God that's out there. And God has answered prayers for me in marvelous ways.
Amen.
You know, it's okay to be curious, because my angel is going to roll his eyes when he sees me coming, and he's going to say, okay, Stan, what have you got today? I just wrote down a few questions that I have. It's okay. God likes curiosity. He isn't warmed over by doubt, but genuine curiosity will get the attention of God. Remember Moses, burning bush? When Moses went over, I shall now look and see why this bush is not burning up. And God said, and the scripture says, and when God saw that he went over to look at the bush, then he spoke to him. So God is open to people with curiosity about him. And Moses said, you know what? When did Moses ask for a peek of God? Was it after the plagues?
Yes.
No. It was way after the plagues. But was it right after the plagues? No. Was it right after the Red Sea closing in on the Egyptian army? I don't know. No. It was when God said, you know what? I will forgive the people for the golden image that they made. I will forgive them for that. I will. Then God said, you know what? I'd like to know more about you. Can I see you? Oh, man! And God said, yeah, I'll let you see everything you can handle. I love it. So, guess what? Take a look at the book of Job today, this afternoon. Read the story, the part where God is speaking to Job. It is the longest, uninterrupted talk by God in Scripture. God is speaking for several chapters. It's interesting. And he talks about his creation. And he's basically bragging to Job about the cool things he's made. You seen this animal? You seen this? Hey, check this out. You know, to kind of give Job a sense of, you know, I got this, Job. But one of the things that's very interesting to me, he said, have you seen the ostrich that I made? Yeah, he's kind of a dumb bird. Look it up! He said, I didn't give him much intelligence. He does some dumb stuff, doesn't he? I'm almost wondering, why did he say that to Job? Is he saying to Job, you know what? I sometimes could have given more gray matter. I could have. For my purposes, I don't always give every single creature I have incredible IQs and you know, and everything. Maybe work with me. Trust me. We'll give you all you can handle. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Tell me if you understand how I created everything. When I said, let there be light, and there was light. Tell me how I did that. Okay. And Job has a very good answer after God's through. You know what? Maybe I ought to be quiet now. I'll be quiet now. And God doesn't correct that. So, when God tells us that certain things have happened, maybe we should take him at his word.
Amen.
It's a proper response because maybe we don't have all the gray matter right now to follow everything that he has done. But I think someday we will. Okay, so back to this statement. Sing with a loud voice. I like that. As Doug Batchelor will say, with a megaphone. That's in Greek. Megaphone, with a loud voice. I like it when our scientists are very open about their beliefs. There's tremendous pressure in the scientific community to be very quiet if you believe in God, let alone creation. Don't even think you're going to get any papers published or anything. There are lots of pressure. To me, though, I'd like to see all of us come out of the closet and say with a loud voice, I'm a believer in creation. I tell kids, God is looking for creation warriors. He's looking for kids who want to be scientists, who believe in God and love to study the things he's made. All right, cool. So let's do it with a loud voice. Because as we all look at the news today, and we're going to talk about some of this tonight when we talk about where did God go, this planet is messed up. Amen? It sure looks like it to me. This planet is messed up, but you know what? I believe this, that Jesus has got this. Jesus has got this planet. The problems that we see will soon be ended. God is a judge too, and that's not bad news. That's part of the gospel. He's not going to let everything fall apart forever. He's going to fix it. And are we part of the solution or part of the problem?
Solution.
Hopefully we're part of the solution. And let's join in with the loud voice this message. Amen?
Amen.
Are you ready?
Amen.
You ready for the events that's coming?
Amen.
Because someday, we're going to hear on the news, the Seahawks are in training camp. There's another scandal going on in Washington. There's this movie star and this movie star are going to break up. This epidemic is starting. This warfare is going on in a nation. Over, you know, we're hearing this, that, and the other. And you know what? The end will come. And that'll be the last day of this planet. Like the flood, without warning. And you know what? That's not bad news. That's good news. Unless you're not ready. This whole town is full of people, many of which are not ready.
Amen. Amen.
And if we love them like God loves them, we'll let them know
Amen. That
he's about ready to come.
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this message. It's the first angel's message is to go to the world with the everlasting gospel. Come back to God as creator, the message goes. He's got good news. He's also the judge, and that's good news, because he's going to take care of our case through his son. Heavenly Father, this good news needs to go out with a loud voice. And I pray, Lord, that for those here who have friends, family, neighbors that can come maybe to tonight or to any other meetings that this church is putting on, that we will do that and kind of raise the volume to a loud voice.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we know that your spirit and your angels will be present with us as we do that. And we just thank you, Lord, that there will be that day coming soon. Jesus returns in the clouds, and I cannot wait for that day. Lord, may it come soon, but not until everyone's ready that we can get ready. That's our prayer today in Jesus' name.